Let's go ahead and open in a word of prayer, and then we'll say a couple things and get our service started. Please remain standing. Lord God, this is another blessed day for us to come into your house. Even as the sun shines bright outside, we know that you, the Son of God, shines bright in our lives. And as the world walks in darkness, that we can live in the light. We read in Scripture, Lord, about your glory and how it's always portrayed as a monumentally bright light. So we know that even the light we live in now is but a shadow of the glory that is to come. We pray, Lord, that you help us to resonate upon that today, to reflect upon how great you are and the things that you're doing in our lives. If we bring struggles in here today, God, we ask that you would speak to us directly in regards to those. Help us to see what we can do about them and what we can't. How we're being obedient and how we're not. The ultimate obedience might be there for somebody today as well, Lord. That they would be challenged to give their life to you. Or somebody who's, they've been saved. They've received your Holy Spirit. They've made a profession of faith, but they haven't yet done so publicly in water baptism, that you would impress upon them the need to be obedient to that end today. And to come forward at the end of this service, like the two young ladies who will be baptized here today, Lord, who just recently walked down in the front of this church and told us about it. Now we get to celebrate this wonderful rite of baptism in their lives, and we pray, God, that you especially pour your Spirit out on that, even as you pour your Spirit out on this entire service. And to you be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations. Amen. You can be seated. How's everybody today? I'm glad to hear it. I too am doing well and excited about the service that we have planned for you. Welcome to Philadelphia Baptist Church today. There's a couple things that I want to mention that are in your bulletin. One of the main things is you see lately that we have our men on missions and our women on missions starting to gather together again and make plans. We're going to have our second since the return of men and women on missions after the last several months. We're going to have our second women on missions meeting next Sunday at 5 o'clock. Our second men on mission meeting is tonight at 5 o'clock, and our first Men on Mission project will be next Saturday, the 12th, and we're meeting at 8 a.m. And we're meeting in two locations, all right? There's Wanda Bradford's house over in Locust, and that will be for anybody who's going to help build the ramp at her house. And I want to tell you something, she's excited about this ramp, all right? And we get an opportunity to serve her, and in doing so, we serve in the body of Christ and help out one of our own. And so we're going to be building her a ramp. So you have ramp building skills, please help. If you have no ramp building skills, please help. You could be a gopher. You know, you go for this and you go for that and you run around. But if you're like me and you're probably more of a hindrance than a help to the ramp building process, or really anybody who's not going to help build the ramp, we need you over here at the church, and we're going to be scraping and cleaning off the walls down in the fellowship hall in the basement in preparation for sealing and painting them to get them all looking real good. And maybe part of the motivation is that our new associate pastor, our new youth pastor, starts next week. Maybe we want to pretty it up for him a little bit, you know, and get him excited about putting kids in that basement. But we also want it to be safe. We want it to look good. So we're getting it sealed and paint, but we're saving a lot of money by doing it ourselves. So please, men, come out. Bring your sons. Bring your grandsons. And whoever else you know, this is also an opportunity for youth and boys to serve along with us. And once again, remember that when we do our girls' activities as well, ladies, please include your daughters, granddaughters, etc. There's also, by the way, you'll see as we start to get things kind of going again, you'll see that Bible journaling is going to restart on Saturday, September 20th. So please talk with my wife if you'd like more information on that. A couple people I want to bring to your attention. Robert Little is still on our prayer list, so you see his name there. But he did. So Robert had, it was a pretty serious, heart attack, and he's home now. He had to go back to a hospital. Was it Friday night or last night?
Friday night.
It was Friday night. That's right, because he sent it to me yesterday morning. It's serious, but he's home, and we're glad for that. But he gets really drained. He can't, you know, if he gets up and try to go to the restroom or walk to the kitchen or something, he's drained before he can even get there. So it's a lot of sitting around. So he asked that. He said that as much as he loves everybody, he loves your prayers and loves your support, that nobody visit right now, and it's not really because of COVID. It's more that just that he just doesn't have the energy for it. But continue to keep Robert Little in your prayers and Alma as well. And also then it was, Cynthia, it was Doris's niece who called? Yeah, Doris Edwards' niece called Cynthia to have her put on the prayer list, and we just kind of got a little more information. I've noticed Doris hasn't been around for the last few weeks, and I know that, you know, that's not a COVID thing either, because Doris was here like as soon as we opened the doors again. And so kind of think about that. Where's Doris been? Well, it turns out that she's kind of getting worse. And I don't know if you know this, but Doris is dealing with Parkinson's, and that it's kind of getting worse for her. She's not really able to get out. But one thing they are looking for, too, is somebody start staying with Doris. So if you know a good godly person could fill that role, or maybe you're the good godly person that could fill that role, I encourage you to do what you can to get in touch with Doris Edwards. And what's her niece's name? Do you remember?
Carol.
Carol. You don't know her last name, do you?
Yeah.
Carol Smith. All right. So keep that in mind. What, Beth, what was your aunt's name again?
Joyce Hatley Murray.
Joyce Hatley Murray. If y'all, any of y'all know her, I think she was a member of Red Cross. But she passed away here recently. I know she wasn't a member of this church, but it's not that big a community. And if you're kind of wondering more about that, you can talk with Beth Allman. That's Beth Allman there, right? Hey, like that. So, and she, but she lived over behind Big Lick, right? So she lived right there in Big Lick. So I wanted to let you know about that as well. As always, I know I am forgetting something because I always do, but I'm going to go ahead, and there's a lot of missions emphasis. You see, 3 out of 5 things in this under announcements in our bulletin are missions. So there's a lot of missions things going on in our church right now. We're about to kick off something here this month with North Carolina missions. We'll show you more videos on that next week. But we're also still doing our Appalachian backpack, so I want to let Becky show you a couple pictures and come and talk about that for a second.
So last year, we decided to actively participate in the Appalachian Christmas Outreach Mission Project, or Backpack Project, but we didn't know much about the distribution or how it took place. So Ruby and I kind of speculated about it a little bit. We didn't know if they gave the backpacks directly to the kids, or if the parents picked them up and gave them to them later, or what exactly took place. So when the invitation came from Kenza to participate, Terry and I decided that we would go for the distribution, which was on December 10th of last year. We didn't actually travel up there with the group from Kenza to Ashe County because they left at Stanfield at 4:00 in the morning. So we went up the night before and stayed in that area, and then went over and met with them at 7:30 the next morning. And the distribution took place at the old Ashe County School Gymnasium. So our group, of course, provided the backpacks, and it covered ages 4 to 17, just like we're making this year, 850 of them all together. There were other churches, of course, in our area that participated, just like we did, to make up that 850. And that was only a part of the distribution. Businesses and churches and individuals in that area provided Christmas presents for the kids. So there were large black bags with wrapped gifts inside of them, and sometimes a bike to go with them or some other large item. Some months earlier, people that felt like they would need help getting Christmas gifts for their kids had signed up with social service in that county. And if it was determined that they did need help, then a letter was sent out to them allowing them to list 3 things that their children might want for Christmas. And so these wishes were then distributed to people in that area. And people in that area bought the gifts and brought them back to the social service department. So some of the group from Kinza had gone up earlier in the month to help wrap those Christmas presents. And people that had previously been notified that they would receive some help came on the day of the distribution to pick up those gifts and that backpack. I worked as a runner, so we would get a number that was attached to a particular person, and then we would go and find the bag that matched that number, and then sometimes there was a bicycle or some other item that went along with it. So Terry somehow ended up with the job of helping people carry their items to their car. And that sometimes was a problem because people would come in these average size or small cars, and then he would have to try to stuff these big bags of Christmas gifts, and sometimes more than one big bag of Christmas gifts and bicycles and other things into those cars. And let's just say that it was a cold and rainy day in the mountains that day, so he was in and out in the rain all day as well. But we got to meet and talk to a number of really good people from the Ashe County area that came and volunteered, you know, along with us, including David Blackburn, who is the associational missionary in that area, and we also met several of the pastors from the Ashe County area. A few of the gifts especially caught my attention. One child had asked for a bed. So there was actually a bed, headboard, footboard, and frame for that child. And one older kid had asked for a tree stand to hunt with. So it was wrapped, but it was obviously a tree stand. And then someone had actually donated a laptop for one of the older kids. So let's just say we were tired at the end of the day, and Terry was a little wet. And one other thing, he had actually had to travel with a couple of people to their homes in our truck to take their items because they couldn't get them in their car, so he actually followed them home and took their items for them. And so going in and out in the rain all day, he was a little wet, and we were tired, but it was a very heartwarming thing to be a part of this and to just witness the generosity of so many people. And yes, along with the gifts, they were given a backpack that matched the age and gender of each child. And so there had to be some very happy faces, I think, on Christmas Day there in the Appalachian area of North Carolina. So let's do that again. Let's bring the love of Jesus in a practical way through these backpacks, so that on Christmas morning they can be a lot more happy faces in that area, and because the love of Christ compels us to do so. There was also, Larry and James, a Gideon there that day who gave out testaments and Bibles to anybody that was interested in getting the scriptures. So I have just a couple pictures to show you, I think, Scott. When you're working like that, you don't really have time to take a lot of pictures, but I wanted you to see that it was pretty impressive to look out over that 850 big bags of Christmas gifts. And you can see there, it was not, you know, not your little 13-gallon trash bag. These were these huge, I don't know, construction bags or lawn and leaf bags or something that were filled with Christmas gifts. And so those were the Christmas gifts in the black bags. And then there were the backpacks, 850 of them. There was a section, Kinza Church people ended up giving out all those, and so there was a section for the boy backpacks and the different ages, and then there was a section for the last picture of the girl backpacks. So there was a lot of backpacks and a lot of Christmas gifts given out that day to the parents. So a couple of things I need to tell you just as far as preparing our backpacks. We have ribbons up here, and Sandy has put some at the back that they ask you to tie a ribbon on the backpacks instead of trying to tape them or put something on there that won't stay. But if you'll tie a ribbon, a pink one for a girl, blue one for a boy, and we have all these ribbons already cut for you so everybody doesn't have to go out and buy a ribbon. And then, of course, each age gets a particular ribbon. And if you will look on your, if you got one of those information sheets in the beginning that tells you what to pack in your backpack, then it also tells you what color ribbon to put with your particular age and gender of backpack. And we have a list there as well by the ribbons that tells you that same thing. So just get the proper ribbons that you need. And also we have the Christmas story already printed out for you that's supposed to go in each backpack. And we put them in sheet protectors so that you can put them down in your backpack and they won't get all crumpled up. So pick up one of those at either here or at the back of the church as well. We will collect all these or try to collect all these by the 27th of September. That's our goal, so that we can have that finished up and be able to begin our Operation Christmas Child. And I see a few people have already brought their backpacks, so that's a wonderful thing. And on the 27th, we will pray over our backpacks before they leave us and go to the Kinza area to be transported to Ashe County. So if you have any questions or anything that comes up that you need to know, you can ask me or Ruby Brooks or Sandy Whitley, and we'll be glad to help you.
Let's all stand and sing Jesus, our Lord and King.
And it's the same tune as Breathe On Me, Breath of God.
baptized. But in there we have a verse, and it's Romans 6:4. And in Romans 6:4 it tells us that we are, even as we are buried with Christ in death, we are raised with him in the newness of life. Baptism marks a transition point in a person's life. The old person has died, we lower him down. The new person has risen again, washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. Good. Warm is better than cold, I'll tell you what. Can you see him? There you go. I don't need to pick you up, do I? Stand up for a minute. They need to see you good. There you go. Dad, you got a good picture? He's got it. This is Violet Saldana. Violet, is it your unashamed profession of faith that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior? She said yes. Violet Saldana, based on your unashamed profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we baptize you as our sister in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ, and risen again. She's a little taller. This is Amy Saldana. Amy, is it your public and personal confession of faith that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Amy Saldana, based on your unashamed profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we baptize you as our sister in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ, and risen again. Let us pray. Lord God, we celebrate with these young ladies. We celebrate with their family. We celebrate as a church family. And we thank you for the profession of faith that they have made and that they presented in the rite of baptism before us today. We pray, God, that you use this day and this experience, this ordinance, to impress upon them the rest of their lives, the newness of life that they walk in. We pray, God, that you do such amazing things in these young ladies' life that it far surpasses anything that we could possibly imagine. We pray, God, that you help us as a congregation to come around them and to raise them up in the way they should go. And you also continue to anoint their parents as you have thus far, because they've done such a good job in teaching these young ladies about you, that you continue to anoint their parents. As these young ladies will start to grow older and the influences this world impress upon them, that they can continue to guide them in your ways. We thank you so much for this opportunity to celebrate this day with you. To you be the glory, as always. In Jesus' name, amen.
4, verse 14, says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmity, but within all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. The song was written so that we may know as Christians that our God, our Savior, our high priest in heaven is not so high that we can't personally come to him. Jesus is reachable. Jesus is there for us. This song has so much passion in the word that is said. It shows that our Savior was tempted just like we are. Yet we fall short. Our Savior does not. Our Savior never fell short. Our Savior never lied. Our next Savior never done anything. Despite what the world tries to tell us, that Jesus sinned is a lie. The world tries to say Jesus drank, and I'm going to say it, drank wine that was fermented. It is untrue. Jesus drank something like grape juice. Jesus would never cause somebody to sin. As the verse says, Jesus was tempted like we are. He was tempted, but he done no sin. This song tells us that Jesus is reachable for us. He's there for us, for our salvation, for our eternity. Jesus won't fail us. Praise God for the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus. Jesus.
Did you get sermon card in your bulletin? Something for you to follow along with. One of the things is it's been a while since I preached a purely topical message, so I'm kind of excited about it. Once again, a purely topical message in a sense would be that you have a subject matter and then you pull different spots from the Bible to then support what it is that the message is teaching. I still think it's expository in the sense that you still provide exposition of every single verse, but nevertheless, it is a topical message, and that means that it's a little harder for you maybe to jump around your Bible, so you might, that's when that card really comes in handy, even if you're not a fill-in-the-blank person. But also, there will be the words up on the screen for you as well. And if you're really good at it, then make the jump. Jump back and forth. So it'll be like kind of a Bible quiz on you for that purpose. Let me see. Amy, you already out? You already dried up? Here, I got something for you. Come forward and get your baptism certificate. Violet, you back there? Come on forward too as well. So, certificate of baptism. She baptized at Philadelphia Baptist Church. Here you are. How to do this? Left hand. There you go. There we go. Give her a hand. There you go. Give her a hand. Can't tell you how many times in the past we've had those made, and then I have them with me, and I think I'll give them to them after church, and then I forget. And then it's like 2 weeks later, I've still got them. And like a month later, their parents finally get them. But I like it. It's so much nicer to hand it to them, right? Now, parents, you might want to figure out that it goes where it's supposed to go. But, of course, they're girls, so it'll probably go where it's supposed to go. If they were boys, we'd definitely say, go ahead and give it to your parents. Because then we know it's not going to go where it's supposed to go. I'm excited to speak with you today about baptism. The 4 points that you see right here, I used to call them the 5 points of why we get baptized, but you will see that the third point is broken up into two parts, A and B. So really, I think maybe I'll start teaching it this way. And when I say teaching it this way is when somebody comes forward or maybe they contact me or that they're interested in baptism. Then the first thing I want to do is go over and sit with them and talk with them, make sure they understand what baptism means and that they meet the biblical qualification for baptism, which is faith in Jesus Christ. Sometimes people will think, ask them, why do you want to be baptized? I want to tell you, these two young ladies had perfect answers. I've gotten some very interesting answers, but most of those answers, when they're not the right answer in terms of what I need to hear, is when they say, well, I want to be saved. And we kind of got to back up the truck a little bit there, because we don't get baptized to get saved. We get baptized because we are saved. Do you hear the difference? It's a big difference. It's the same reason why we don't act like Christians in order to be saved. We act like Christians because we are saved. We don't serve God in order to be saved. We serve God because we are saved. For those of us who are Christians in this room, we're not at church today to punch our clock and say, maybe this will make sure I'm saved. But we're here today because we are saved, and we want to worship our Lord and Savior. We want to be around other Christians and grow in the Lord and see our God and Father glorified. I made the statement earlier that baptism is a simple yet sacred thing. It is a momentary yet monumental thing. It happens so quickly, but really salvation happens quickly, doesn't it? So quickly that it's indiscernible in many respects. It's a moment of faith. But yet it's a lifetime of living that faith. So let's talk today about why we get baptized. If we're making the statement that says, and really I'll put it this way, if we would say, so you can be saved without water baptism. Well, if you're saved by faith, yes. Then why, somebody would say, why do we get baptized? If it's not that actual sacrament, and I make a distinction between an ordinance and a sacrament. You'll notice that I always call them ordinances. The two ordinances of the church are baptism and what? Lord's Supper, that's right. Baptism, Lord's Supper, two ordinances of the church. When you call it a sacrament, though, that carries with it the idea it is that it's not because of salvation, it is unto salvation. So when we talk about being baptized, we must understand, and I want to give you this first verse from Mark 1:8. We must understand that baptism is symbolic. Go ahead and throw it up on the screen for them. It says, this is John the Baptist speaking. He says, I indeed baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Now, we'll see here that this did not mean that the baptism was only, water baptism was only for a little bit, because then we'll see what Jesus does with baptism and what the apostles do with baptism. But you see here, first of all, that there is symbolism involved. He's saying, I baptize you with water, but one who is coming, who is going to baptize you in the Holy Spirit. So water then represents the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is what happens when we get saved, when the Holy Spirit comes to live in us and we are born again of the seed of God, of the seed of the Holy Spirit, and that seed starts to take root in our lives and then we grow. Water symbolizing then the Holy Spirit. And we're going to see in a moment that when Jesus was baptized, then the Holy Spirit came down in a visible form as a dove. And so you see that connection once made of the symbolism there. So we would say that baptism is a symbolic act. It is symbolism. It is an outward expression of an inner truth. I gave you here also a very famous verse, Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, that remind us that it is completely by faith that we are saved and not of any works. And I think this is very important, because if you must be baptized in order to be saved, then what do you have? You have a work in that you must do in order to be saved. I've even seen Christian systems, denominational systems, that would say not only do you have to be baptized to be saved, but when you come up out of the water, if you're truly baptized in the Holy Spirit, you'll start talking in tongues or some other manifestation of the Spirit. It's just inaccurate. What we have is that by when you have faith in Jesus Christ, by faith alone, you are indwelt with the Holy Spirit. Verse Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For by grace you have been saved through what? Through faith. It doesn't say by grace you have been saved through water baptism or through being at church every week or for giving generous offerings or whatever we could go down that list. For grace you have been saved through faith. It is not of yourselves. It's not of any work you can do, in other words. It's a gift of God, and if you clearly understand, not of works lest anyone should boast. Some of you have probably been trying to share your faith, and you kind of see in somebody's life, you're like, I don't see the Holy Spirit present in this person's life. I don't see a relationship with God and Jesus Christ present in his life. And you might kind of be talking to him. And I say, well, have you been saved? And then in return, some of you heard this one. Well, yeah, I've been baptized. You've been saved. I've been baptized. Well, I didn't ask you if you've been baptized. I asked you if you've been saved. And what that kind of is a little red flag for me is because that's saying, wait a minute, are they basing their salvation on the fact that somebody who is considered clergy or some other church leader baptized them in water? Is that their basis? Because it is by faith that we are saved, not works. With that understanding, it's symbolism, and we need to not misunderstand it as a work. Or I say, well, if I'm saved by faith, then I don't really need to be baptized. And I want to give you four reasons why we get baptized. Four reasons why our faith results in water baptism. The first is this. We get baptized as, number one, obedient children. We get baptized as obedient children. We're described in this way as obedient children by the Apostle Peter in 1 Peter chapter 1. It says, gird up the loins of your mind. Okay, that is, watch the way you think. Check the way you think. Be sober as obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lusts as in your ignorance. The key phrase in the middle of that is as what? Help me out. You're here. As what? As obedient children. How should you act? You should act as obedient children. Now, my Grandfather had a saying that he passed along to my dad and that I'm pretty sure that I've said to my kids a few times, and it was this. It was, if I tell you to jump, you don't say, does anybody know the rest? You don't say how high. What is that communicating? If I say it, you what? You do it. Why? Why do I say it and you do it? Because I'm your parent and you're my child. So if I say it, you do it. And ideally understanding that a parent, it's going to be good for you. It's not going to be bad for you to do it. And with God as our Father, we always know it's going to be good for us. So the principle here is that we be obedient children. If God says it, we do it. Why? Why do we do it? Back that up. Because God, help me, says it. He says it, we do it. As obedient children. And so there are several different choices on this one. The question is, in regards to coming to faith in Jesus Christ, what do we do? In the first chapter of Acts, I'm sorry, the second chapter of Acts, you have a Peter preaching at Pentecost. This is when the first mass salvation of Christians took place. And as he's presenting the issue, he tells them about how they crucified the Christ. He tells them about their sin issue. And when the Holy Spirit then was revealing to them that the magnitude of their sin, they asked the question right before this verse I'm showing. They asked the question, well, what do we do? What do we do? When we come to a point in our lives where we are confronted with our sin and we realize we need a Savior, the question becomes, what do you do? And this is the directions that the Apostle Peter gave them, which by extension then is God giving those directions to him through the Apostle Peter, and God giving those directions to us through the Scriptures. Acts 2:38. What do we do? Peter said to them, repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, that you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This is a very unique time. There's some things we might want to equate here in the order of things that took place, because we would say, well, they got to get baptized in order to receive the Holy Spirit. You'll see some scriptures to show you here in a moment that that's not the case. But we understand this is a very unique time. The first time that the gospel is preached after Jesus' ascension into heaven, and these first people will come to Jesus Christ. And so we see that this is a monumental time in the life of the church. But once again, the connection is made between the gift of the Holy Spirit that you're doing nothing to get because it's a gift, and the baptism that is going to come by water. And you're being baptized in whose name? Whose name does it say there? In your own name? In the name of the church? Whose name? In Jesus' name. That means that that's the one that you're placing your faith and your trust in. You're being baptized in Jesus' name. He said you need to repent, and then the sign of that repentance is going to be, and then be baptized. If they were standing there and said, yeah, I repent, but I don't think I need to go do that baptism thing right down there. Two problems. One, you're saying that you're going to become a child of God, and your first act is to be disobedient. That's a problem. But then that might also beg the question of this. Are you really repenting? Are you really repenting? Are you not going down there because deep down in your heart, you know you're not really there yet? We're baptized as obedient children. God says it, we do it. And by the way, we'll get to a verse in here, or actually we won't be able to pull up. We're not going to pull up the Great Commission as it is at the end in Matthew chapter 28, but it says to go into, we're told as a church to go into all the world and to baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. So when we as God's people are carrying this out, we're doing it because why? Because God says so. We're doing it because God says so, and the people who are then doing it, that we're leading them in it, are doing it then as in part because God says so. One of the reasons that we get baptized is very simply as obedient children. If we become children of God, we're now to live a life in which God says it, I'm supposed to do it. Ideally, baptism, water baptism, and salvation are very close together in their timing. And it really is, if that's the case, when it ideally is, somebody is saved and then they are baptized shortly thereafter. When that's the case, it is kind of, you kind of think, well, wait a minute, if then I get saved, but then the thing I'm supposed to do right away I don't do, my first act as a child of God is disobedience. That doesn't make sense. So number one reason why we get baptized as obedient children. Number two, why we get baptized as Christ's disciples. We get baptized as Christ's disciples. I'm fishing for an answer here, so somebody's going to know the answer and probably get nervous and not say it. That's what usually happens. But what's another word for disciple? Somebody help me. All right, I'm not getting anybody. Starts with an F. All right. My daughter got that? Did you know before I said the F? But why did you didn't say anything because you were nervous you'd get it wrong? She whispered it in your ear. See, I predicted it, didn't I? Somebody's going to know this and not say, by the way, Kaylee, you just made me and mommy look very good, honey. Thank you. All right. There was a Nathan joke in there, but I'm going to leave him alone. Everybody's like, you need to be softer on Nathan. Okay, I'm going to leave Nathan alone. As Christ's disciples, as Christ's followers. So if we're a follower of Christ, that means that we do like him, right? We're Christ's disciples, we're Christ's followers. I'm going to give you Luke chapter 3, verse 21 through 22. When all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also was baptized. And while he prayed, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended in bodily form like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven which said, you are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased. In whom I am well pleased. You notice once again the connection between spirit baptism and water baptism. Water baptism is meaningless without spirit baptism. We must understand that. Spirit baptism saves you. Water baptism represents spirit baptism. God is a God of symbolism, and quite often he will give us physical symbols of spiritual truths. What does the Holy Spirit take the form of here? A dove. Does that mean the Holy Spirit's a bird? No. Why did the Holy Spirit take the form of a dove? So that they could see the Holy Spirit. Because that does not mean that every Christian who gets saved, the Holy Spirit becomes a dove and descends on them. This is once again a huge moment. This is the Savior of the world getting baptized. And at that point, it's very important that they would understand the connection between spirit baptism and water baptism. That connection has always got to be made. You look at the end and it says, you are my beloved Son, in you I am well pleased. Is that to assume that the Father was not pleased with God the Son right before his baptism? No. He's never displeased with him. The point I'm getting at is this. If anybody didn't need to be baptized, I'm pretty sure it was Jesus. Wouldn't you agree? Did he need to get baptized? I believe one of the real reasons is under this heading right here that Jesus got baptized is he was showing us the way we should go. That we would model after him. So you see here that when all the people were baptized, Jesus didn't separate himself from them. He included himself in it, and that Jesus himself came and was baptized. And if you say, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, and Jesus would get baptized, then what do? I get baptized. And then if you say, well, yeah, I mean, I'm saved. I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, but I don't want to do that. I get really nervous up in front of people, that kind of thing. Really? That's going to be your measure of being a follower of Christ. Anytime you're nervous, you're not going to do what Christ would do. I want to tell you something. You're going to have a very difficult walk with the Lord. Because he will often call us to do things that make us nervous and that challenge us. And on the other side of them, we're going to go, Lord, I'm so glad that you pushed me to do that. I'm so glad you made me walk through that door. We're supposed to be followers of Jesus Christ. Jesus was also baptized, so we follow then in his footsteps. Just to clarify that this is a biblical principle, once again, I want to give you another verse from 1 Peter. This one's chapter 2, verse 21. He says, "For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example, that you should follow his steps." And that's the new, all these are New King James verses here. That's not a paraphrase. That's not even a New Living or the Message translation or anything like that. It's a very little, very simply, that you should follow his steps. If there's something I see that Jesus emphasized, then that's something in my life that needs to be emphasized. You say you become a child of God? Are you an obedient child? That'll tell a lot about whether you really are a child of God. You say that you're a follower of Jesus Christ. Are you following him down like he did into the waters of baptism? And by the way, well, I'll mention this more here at the end in point number 4, but you'll notice when Jesus got baptized, it was at the beginning of his earthly ministry. It was at the beginning of his earthly ministry. And it's the same way for us. When we get saved, that begins our earthly ministry. I was saved when I was 24 years old. At 24 years old, that began my earthly ministry. Everything before that was the old guy, born of the flesh. Everything since that's the new guy, born of the Spirit. Same way, Jesus got baptized at the beginning of his earthly ministry. And that's another reason why it's very important, as much as possible, to tie in water baptism with our conversion experience. But some of you may say, you may be even out there right now, and you're like, well, I got saved a long time ago, and I've never been baptized, and I guess at this point I just kind of, you know, leave it like it is. Well, that doesn't really make sense. If you're supposed to get baptized as close to your conversion as you can, and it's been 10 years, what are you going to wait, 15? You're going to keep spreading it out? No, it's time to walk through that obedience door. It's time to walk through that follower of Jesus door. Recognizing your ministry began a while ago, but maybe now it's going to take on a new meaning for you, having then followed Jesus into the waters, have been obedient to God the Father into the waters, waters that represent that Spirit baptism that saves us. So number 1, we get baptized as obedient children. Number 2, we get baptized as Christ's disciples. And number 3, we get baptized as a testimony to others. We get baptized as a testimony to others. I would need more fingers and toes, by the way, to tell you, to count, all right, because I am going to tell you, but to count how many people have asked me if they could just do a private baptism because of that whole getting up in front of people and being nervous thing. And you know what my answer was? No. No. You know why? Because we're not supposed to have a private faith. Are you ashamed? I'm just nervous. Well, good, because you don't want to be ashamed to get up there and announce your faith to others. As Jesus said, if you are ashamed of me before men, I will what? Be ashamed of you before my Father in heaven. So that's not a place you want to be. And so we break through those barriers. And we will constantly be challenged as Christians, as we live out our earthly ministry, we will be constantly challenged as Christians to keep our faith private, won't we? The world wants you to keep your faith private. Keep it to yourself. Keep it to yourself. Are you going to believe what you want to believe? But keep it to yourself. Don't impress it upon me. But our lives are to be testimonies to the people who are around us. And really, this breaks into two different groups. But before I talk about those two groups, I want to give you then Acts 1:8, which is considered another Great Commission verse. Says, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be what? Witnesses to me." That doesn't mean you're witnessing to Christ. That means you're witnessing of Christ. We are witnessing, bearing witness of people to Jesus Christ. Hey, this is Jesus Christ. You can see Jesus through the... Let me introduce you to Jesus Christ. I love the fact right here that it reminds us that this is not something you do under your own power. You do it under the power, it says, of the Holy Spirit. That you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. When you are baptized in the Holy Spirit, you will receive power. And this isn't just about making you feel really spiritual All right? This isn't about just making you know I'm saved and I could scream about it from the rooftops. This is to make sure that you do scream it from the rooftops, understanding that part of being saved is the power of the Holy Spirit to be a witness of Jesus Christ to the people in the world around us. So we say back up, say, no, I'm not going to do that because you're not going to start off your Christian walk keeping your faith private. That's a bad foundation to lay, because a big part of water baptism is being a testimony to others. And once again, you break this up into two groups. Really, from the perspective, I know that there are all kinds of groups that we set apart in the world, you know, male, female, black, white, Democrat, Republican, all these different groups that we'll make up, things we'll establish, Methodist, Baptist, everything like that. When it really comes down to it, there's two groups of people in this world. There's the lost and there's the saved. And we hope to make the lost group smaller and the saved group bigger. Amen? Amen. That's what we're going for. But when you break it down into those two groups, and you're a testimony to others, that means you're going to be a testimony to the lost, you're going to be a testimony to the saved. We're going to word it this way. First of all, it's a testimony to the world. All right? That would be the lost world, the world living in the dark. A testimony to the world. When I came to Christ, and I shared this, Violet and Amy heard this story recently. They've heard a lot of these points recently. Sound familiar, Amy? All this? What do you think? Better from the pulpit or from your couch? She doesn't know how to answer that question. Pulpit. Better pulpit. I'm better at the pulpit. I'm pretty sure. I tell the story of that when I got saved, I had a buddy of mine, and I obviously was going to church then because I was excited about Jesus, and I had a buddy of mine who I'd gone to high school with, and let's just put it this way, we weren't up to much good, all right? But then he kind of was talking about interested in church and everything, and I said, well, hey, man, you know, come to church. Well, then he ends up coming to church, and he ends up getting saved. Now, his parents, they didn't like me too much because I had to be the bad influence on him, right? You know what the truth was? We were bad influence on each other. That's what the truth was, all right? We were in it. We were in cahoots, all right? We were running together. But his parents, they were like, you know, many times, Carrie, you can't hang out with Carrie anymore. Carrie can't come over, this kind of thing, because we were rowdy. Well, at the day that my friend got baptized, his parents came to his baptism. Now, I want to know something about his parents. His parents were great people. Really awesome people. But I never knew anything. There was no God in their life or really even church. I think they were Lutheran by birth, but I never heard them going actually doing anything with church. He said a couple times for like baptisms and stuff he had gone to church, but those were baby baptisms. Those were infant baptisms and things. So basically they were of the world. They were good people, but they were lost people. I'd never heard anything about God or church in their life, and I'd known them for about 10 years, hanging around with their son every day. But when they came to his baptism, you know what they did? You know what happened? They came back every Sunday after that. You know what ended up happening? They got baptized. They made a profession of faith. They got baptized. And then after that, the same guy who had banned me from his house many times when I was younger was actually a year later on a mission field with me in Guatemala, and we were serving people in Jesus' name together. That was my friend's dad. You see how his baptism, none of his, hey, you should come to this church, it's really good, got him to church. But when they came to see his baptism, they saw that and it challenged them enough to keep coming to church, and eventually they came to saving knowledge. Part of it is our witness to the world, and God will cause us to be a witness to the world. A lot of us get really nervous, like, I don't know what to say, I don't know what to do. Well, isn't it great that the first witnessing opportunity that God gives us, we don't have to really say or do much, do we? In fact, I tell people when you get back to it, don't worry, I do all the work, you know? I'm the one who can mess this up. All you got to say is yes and let somebody push you underwater. Most of us can handle that. But by us doing that, it testifies especially to lost people who would know. As it says in 1 John chapter 5, there are three that bear witness on the earth, the spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree as one. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God which he has testified of his Son. He who believes in the Son has this witness in himself. When we come to saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, we believe in the Son. We now have this witness in ourselves. And when we get baptized, that witness is coming out and it is impacting the lost people who are around us. It may be challenging somebody who's saved but has not yet been baptized, and they realize their need for obedience. But it challenges them. But more importantly, it challenges the lost around us to consider faith in Jesus Christ. And you see here, I gave you the whole scripture because it's tying together the Holy Spirit, the blood of Jesus Christ, and then the bridge in the middle of those two is what? Water. There's been a lot of different interpretations of these verses and what the water means. I see clearly in Scripture what the water means. The water is representation of passing from an old life into a new life, and it represents the Holy Spirit. It's a physical manifestation of spiritual truths. But this is in us, this witness. But also, it's not just people. Most of the people in this room today are not of the world. You're Christians. That's why you're at church, right? It's not only a witness to lost people, but it's a witness to Christians as well. We call that to the church. To the church, letter B. To the church. For you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. What this is reminding us of at the beginning, for you are all sons of God. You are all children of God there, all right? You could say you're all children of God. It would be the same thing as sons of God. We all become children of God. Have you ever noticed that when a baby is born in a family, it's not just the mother and father who celebrate? You notice that? Oh, the aunts and the uncles and the grandparents and everybody's excited and everybody's come around. Why? Because they're family. I mean, you think about right here, so, you know, we'll pick on Ruby, why not? So, you know. So Ruby has a grandchild that was born. It's your grandchild. Who's going to be more excited, you or me? It's your grandchild. You, right, why? What's the difference? His family. That's right. And as Christians, we're family. And so we celebrate when we say, it's coming out, and you're saying, I'm one of you. I'm one of you. I'm part of the family. That's why we get so excited as a church. We celebrate another family member who is one with us. How do we know? How do we recognize who the family is? It says right here, verse 27, for as many as you who are baptized into Christ have put on Christ. But you can't physically see whether somebody has faith in Christ. They got to express it. And the first way they express it is what? In that water baptism. In that water baptism. By the way, that also has to do with the body of Christ, and the body has many members, and so they're telling that they're part of the body with us. They are one with us. So, three reasons we get baptized: as obedient children, as Christ's disciples, and as a testimony to others, and then lastly is this, as a rite of transition. As a rite of transition. R-I-T-E, not R-I-G-H-T. As a rite of transition. A rite is a formal or ceremonial act. You know, you can, all that you really need to be baptized is a signature on a piece. I mean, I'm sorry. All you really need to be married is a baptized, I'm getting all messed up, is a signature on a piece of paper. You know that? That's really all you need, is somebody who's authorized to sign that piece of paper. That's what makes you married. It's kind of funny to me to do a wedding, and then I say, I now pronounce you man and wife and do this, and they're actually not married until I sign that piece of paper. So it's kind of weird in that way. But we don't put much on the sign of the piece of paper. We put a lot more on the ceremony, don't we? Why do we have ceremonies? Because important things require important recognition, don't they? Why do we go to these forever boring graduations? Can I get a witness? Why do we go and sit for hours for that split second when that loved one will come and their name will be said. Because it's important. It's an important transition point. We have ceremonies. We have rites, R-I-T-E, things that we do at important transition points. And this baptism is a rite of transition. It is a formal ceremonial act marking the transition of the person from the old life to the new life. This is a verse that I quoted from the tub earlier, Romans chapter 6, verse 4. We were buried with him through baptism unto death, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father. Even so, we also should walk in the newness of life. It represents a transition point in somebody's life. The old has gone, the new has come. What do I say? Buried with Christ and risen again. Go on, walk in the newness of life. And then we pray what for what? The rest of their Christian life, that life that they're leading, well, what God will do. It's a rite of transition. And as we recognize that rite of transition, we realize this. It doesn't have anything to do with how faithful we've been in our walk, how much money we've given to the church, what our attendance is like, how good we are at sharing our faith. I'm just trying to think of all these righteous acts that we would think about. What it's about is it's about a representation, a physical representation of a spiritual truth. I have been saved. I have become a new creation in Christ Jesus. The old has gone and the new has come. And that's why it's so powerful, I think, on this last verse we look and we see the only prerequisite for baptism. It says, can anyone, this is Acts 10:47. This has been, by the way, when Peter has gone and he has seen that the gospel has transitioned to, has also extended to the Gentiles. He didn't believe it when he first heard it. And so he went to see for himself. And he saw that they had received the Holy Spirit, that they had been saved. And this is what he said. Can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? It's all about a marking of a transition. He saw that they received the Holy Spirit and he said what? The next thing they need to do is what? Get baptized. And he said, and can anybody forbid it? A guy who doubted their salvation when he walked into the room said, can anybody forbid this? Because they have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. He saw the transition point had taken place in these people's lives. And he said, this needs to be represented, presented in water baptism. Can anyone forbid water? I want to let you know something. If you've come to saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, ain't anybody in this church going to forbid you the waters. We're not going to forbid you the waters. You're not going to come up and we're not going to tell you, well, you're not from the right side of the track, so we're not going to baptize you. Well, you're not dressed the way we dress, so we're not going to baptize you. Or all the other bad reasons that I could think of. That's the only reason I meet with people, really. I try to explain all this stuff and meet with people before we baptize them is to make sure that I could say like this, they have received the Holy Spirit just as we have, and that is the only prerequisite. A transition has taken place in their life. And now we recognize that rite of we give them a rite of transition as they walk in the newness of life. I do want to encourage you as we finish up with our songs here today. We sing our final hymn. It's a great opportunity for you to come forward if you've never been water baptized. And I look out today, there's a couple people I wish were here today hearing this. Maybe you'll hear it on YouTube later, and it'll challenge you, and you'll walk up next week. But if you're here today and you haven't been water baptized, if you have or you will place your faith in Jesus Christ and your Lord and Savior, don't leave here today not following through in obedience, not following your Savior into the waters. Make today the day that we celebrate with you your commitment to then in a couple weeks or even sooner be celebrating with you in there. Will you please stand? Let's sing. I'm going to be down here to receive anybody who would come forward today. You can also come forward for other reasons. Remember, you can come forward and join this church. You can come forward for prayer, whatever it may be. Let's sing.